They are skillful.
Hello, art family, and thank you to all the new subscribers. The very generous people at the Miya Art Company sent me their Himi Gouache set with a gouache pad and some brushes to test out. This is their gouache pad. It's glued on the sides so the paper is less likely to curl and crinkle up on you. And this is the brush set they sent me. It has some nice sized brushes. I think it goes up to about a 12 round. They are synthetic brushes, and they seem very durable from what I got from them. So I guess time will tell how they do over a longer period, but they did really well for the sketch. So let's check out the gouache. This is that kind of jelly paint. I've been hearing a lot of people, you know, doing demos and showing this paint, and I was interested to try it out. I like this box set. I was really glad this set came with a white palette, because I've seen some of them come with a colored palette, and I'm not really sure how you mix paint on one that's already colored. But they come in these little kind of wells, and you pull them out and peel the top off, and they're like a kind of a jelly, you know, consistency. This kit in particular also comes with a brush set inside and a little bar space on the bottom so you can store brushes conveniently in the box, which I thought was really handy as well. Okay, I'll save the time of me tediously peeling the lids off. I really like the arrangement of the paints. My only concern I would have would be not having enough white, because I feel like I usually put out two wells of white typically on a project, and white goes pretty fast. So, but they do give you it's a lot of gouache, so it is nice. They're very big wells, which I really like, because you could easily dip a larger brush in, and you have a lot of gouache to work with, especially at the kind of lower price, which is nice. Because this is not kind of the professional grade gouache, I didn't want to do a whole lot of wet into wet. I typically paint with a kind of alla prima approach, so to speak, to borrow a term from oil painting, where I go directly into it without drawing ahead of time. But I didn't want to do too many layers because I wasn't sure how this would hold up to the layering. So I decided to draw with colored pencil so that I could put a kind of wet into wet layer of color on top. So I started by setting up my little still life here. You're almost getting two demos, because off to the right, my daughter, she can't see an open paint box and not join in. So she was doing a painting off to the right, and I was working on my little sketch here. So I started out by drawing with the colored pencil. I did a wet into wet. I found the paper is not necessarily made for the wet into wet, like a heavy wet into wet, but most isn't, because gouache doesn't handle very well, even on the professional, more expensive paints don't handle super well wet into wet. They still tend to kind of crumble and fall apart. That's part of the sort of pro and con of gouache, is it's a good sketching medium. You know, you can get ideas down quickly. It dries very fast. This paint dried very fast. I felt like the colors were very vibrant, and I could use them very directly. I don't usually paint with so many colors, so I was trying to use the broad array of colors and do something that was kind of saturated, so I thought this could be interesting to sketch. I was inspired by my friend Justin, Justin Donaldson, who has been recently painting food, and he actually just posted a Himi gouache demo on his YouTube channel, so you should go check out his as well. But he's been painting food, and I thought it would be fun to do a little sketch of some food, and especially something saturated and bright, like in this case, you know, some sushi in a little tray. So I got to work knocking out all the white on the page. I did find it settled back down, so it sort of curled on the wet into wet, but then it settled back down enough that I wasn't dealing with any, you know, a lot of times when you get a page that curls on you, so, because I even on the Arches 140 pound hot press I usually use, it'll still start to curl a little on you. Then when you're going to do these kind of more thick layers, you sometimes have to compensate for the bumps in the page. So I didn't find I had to do that at all. It laid back down and settled smoothly. And then it kind of got to work, I don't know if you'd call it window shading, but just placing shapes. I was just, you know, I had pre-drawn it, so I was trying to be as direct as possible and apply the paint as thickly as possible, I wasn't sure how it would handle in terms of building layers, so I decided the safer bet would be to try to just shoot straight for the target colors. So I'm trying to think about the saturated intensity of the object. I'm also trying to think about the fact that this is a translucent object. It has subsurface scatter, so light is going through the sort of flesh and bouncing around. And so, you know, on the tuna, the pink in the middle, you're getting orange bits where it's bouncing off the salmon and casting color around. And I liked that sort of interplay of color. I also liked the high contrast, of course, because it's in a very dark container. So you have nice bright colors and a dark container. I'm trying to see how things handle very wet. So I'm painting this large shape, putting some of the lavender color off to the left and some yellow ochre off to the right and some burnt umber in between. But I wanted to see how it spread over a large area and mixed on the page rather than in the palette. And I felt like it held up really well, especially using it as thickly as I'm using it. So I'm using next to no water in this to get this level of saturation, but I feel like it's holding up really well. And now that I have my colorful objects figured out, I'm starting to block in the larger shape of the container itself, which I can then subdivide. Once I get the general shape in, I can start to subdivide the smaller shapes that we're seeing, the kind of plane changes, and then the little bits of reflection here and there. Around the wasabi, there's like some green interplay, and up against the rolls of sushi to the left, you can see where there's a little bit of orange light that's bouncing off the salmon. So I love that. That was something I love. That's something I really like about painting food in general, is you deal with a lot of color and color bouncing around the scene, and it's all very obvious, especially when you're painting from life. If you paint from a photo, you tend to lose a lot of that, as you can kind of tell from my photo. I just took a little snippet of the video and for you to have a reference if you'd like to paint along. And I felt like, you know, if you look at the photo, it's a little bit crunched in terms of values and color saturation. It's not as intense. So it's nice to be able to paint from life when you get the opportunity. I have a hard time painting from life because I have two young kids. So, you know, as you can see, I got it set up and already like both of my kids are coming over, and my son started taking the still life apart, looking at it, trying to look at what it was. And my daughter was wanting to paint along with me, so she's off to the right. You can see her sort of Himi Gouache demo going on over there. She was painting me painting. At this point, I'm starting to put in the highlights to try to kind of put a button on this thing. I think it probably would do you well if you're using this to scoop out some white and maybe set it somewhere else on a palette or something to use. It's hard to work around the fact that you're having to constantly use white once you get your, you know, saturated colors in, and then you need to start elevating the value. You have to use white, so, you know, it is hard to not get your white all mixed up with other colors, because it's only one little puddle of white. So it probably would help to pull some of that out, put it on the palette or something, so you have a clean, or put it on a wet paper towel rather, to keep it moist. Because otherwise you're pulling from the same white. And mine ended up pretty contaminated by the end of this. Although, you know, the lower part's fine, so you could always scrape off or, you know, to try to get to a cleaner version of white. But that usually ends up using a lot of it. So if you buy a set like this, I would recommend buying another white and maybe another of some of the more overused colors, like ultramarine or burnt umber or burnt sienna, depending on what you like to use for your middle gray. When handled thickly and directly, I felt like this gouache really held up, especially for the price it is. It's not very expensive gouache, so I think you'd go into that not expecting quite as vibrant colors, but I feel like the colors were very vibrant and very strong, and I didn't have any issue with blending and blurring them. And some of the parts where it becomes quite chalky or crumbles, that's something I prefer in gouache to have, even in professional, you know, more expensive paints. I like that aspect of gouache and incorporating that kind of crumbliness of gouache to get softer edges here and there to try to allow it to kind of fall apart here and there. So all in all, I really liked the set, and it was very nice of them to send it out to me to try to test out. Me and both my kids had a great time sketching with them. My son did some Zelda characters, and my daughter painted me painting and some other stuff. So we had a great time using it and testing it out. I think it would be interesting to see how it handles after it's been closed for a while, or how it re-wets. That could be an interesting thing to look at next. But I appreciate you watching the video, and I will see you in the next video. In the meantime, happy sketching.